generation. They will tell their children of your awesome God and your mighty acts. They will tell the stories of your faithfulness and glory. And we will pass it on to all who yet to come. You've been so to make it, you're so rich in love, and always celebrate the wonders you and I have given you. Giving you glory, honor, blessing, and faith. Together we'll pass it on, the greatest of your way. Are all your righteousness incomprehensible? Is your unrivaled power and all your promises will stand eternally? Upholding those who fall, uplifting those bowed down, you are near to all. When it's to you we call, so we now shout your name, we celebrate your praise. Giving you glory, honor, blessing, and praise. Together we'll pass it on, the greatest of your way. Giving you glory. Sing it out to me. Pass it on.
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 The wonders you have done.
The wonders you have done.
Oh, oh, oh. Pass it on.
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 Church, you are the
the solid rock. I stand on the ground. Is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. And oh, how I love you more than words can say. Oh, in the deep bass I fell away. Oh, how, Lord, I love you. Once again, receive my prayer. Oh, yeah, one more time, say. Why don't we just applaud the Lord? He's so good.
Well, welcome everyone, Christian Assembly. What a joy and a gift to worship with you today. My name is Jill. I'm one of the community life pastors here. It's great to be with you. And I'm really excited and honored that right now we get to spend a few moments doing baby dedications. And yes, which we are so excited about. And so, across all of our weekend services, we're going to have 7 babies getting dedicated. We have the honor and joy of getting to see 2 of those babies get dedicated here at this service. We at Christian Assembly, we do not do baby baptisms. So we do baby dedications, which is really about the parents who have professed their faith in Jesus saying, I am committed to helping my kids know and follow Jesus. I'm going to take seriously my responsibility as a parent to help my kids love Jesus and know him as best as I possibly can. So we also want to give a very special welcome to family, friends, guests, aunts, uncles, grandparents. If you are joining us for baby dedications, welcome. And we're so glad that you are with us. So I have the honor of getting to invite 2 families on stage. And so first, we want to welcome Bobby and Jenica and their little one, Everly. Come on up. Look how cute she is. Hi, Everly. Hi. Yes, and then we also want to bring up Arby and Lilith and their daughter, Ellie. So come on up. And also, if you're here and you want to get good photos, please feel free to come to the front row or the side aisles. Come down and take as many photos as you would like. But hi, you guys. Oh, is she asleep? Oh, hi, Ellie. Oh, well, you guys, we are so excited to have you with us and these 2 sweet little girls. And it's an honor and joy to get to be part of your baby dedication. And before we pray for you and before we pray with you, I just want to give you guys 2 words of encouragement. And so first, I just want to remind you what God's word says, that children are a gift from the Lord. And so these girls weren't just placed in your lives by chance. They were created by a good God who loves them and knows them and has good purposes for them. And so they truly are a gift that's been given to you guys by God. And so I want to encourage you, don't take that gift for granted. Be thankful and grateful for this good gift God has put in your lives. And then secondly, just want to encourage you, the best gift you can give to these kids is to raise them in a home where you are committed to following Jesus, where you put God at the center of your own life, where you're committed to your own discipleship. So I encourage you, grow in your own walk with Jesus. Pray for your kids, read God's word with your kids. You'll make mistakes because we all make mistakes as parents, but say you're sorry and ask for their forgiveness and model what forgiveness looks like for them. But truly the best gift you could ever give your kids is to teach them what it looks like to follow Jesus all the days of their lives. So it's my joy and honor to get to pray for you guys and with you as you dedicate your babies. I want to invite Matt, who's one of our pastors, to join us up here as we pray for you. And Christian Assembly, it's our custom that if you want to extend your hands, if you feel comfortable, you can extend your hands just as a way of saying, I'm praying with you, I'm praying for you. And so we're going to pray for you guys. Oh, Lord God, we thank you so much for these two families represented up here. And God, we thank you for the good gift of children. And specifically, right now, we thank you for the good gift of little Everly and little Ellie, Lord. And God, I pray for Arby and Lilith. I pray for Bobby and Jenica. We pray for their marriages, Lord. Strengthen their marriages. Be at the center of their homes, Lord. Encourage them in their own walk with you, Lord. And help them to keep following you and to be able to model for their kids what it looks like to follow you, Jesus. Equip them for this great gift you've given them of being parents, Lord. And God, we want to pray for little Everly. And God, we just entrust her into your hands. We pray, Lord, that she would come to know you from the youngest age possible, that she would give her life to you, that she would follow you all the days of her life, that you would use her as your light in this dark world, Lord, that you would use her for your glory and your kingdom. God, give her good friends, and God, give her good works that you want her to do for your glory, Lord. So we entrust little Everly into your hands, Jesus. And God, we pray for Ellie, and we pray, God, for this little sleeping girl. God, we thank you for her. God, we pray that she would know you, that she would love you, that she would follow you, that she would worship you, God. And Lord, that you would use her for your glory. And God, give her health, protect her, Lord, strengthen her. And God, just use her for your kingdom purposes and to bear fruit for you, God. And so, Lord, we entrust these two little ones and these families into your hands. And we also pray, Lord, against the plans of the enemy in these families and in these little girls' lives, Lord. So, God, thank you, thank you, thank you for creating us and for creating these two little ones. We bless them in your name, Jesus. We entrust them in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, congratulations, you guys. You can head off stage, and yeah, you can applaud.
Hello, good evening. My name is Marvin, and Jill gets to bring up cute babies, and now you get me. My name is Marvin, one of the pastors on staff here. Just an incredible pleasure to worship with you this evening. It was powerful. It was amazing. Thank you so much for leaning in and for being with us in worship today. If you came last week to Easter and then you're back today again, welcome. So glad that you are here. Welcome back. Yeah. We can applaud that. In fact, if you are new or visiting this evening, we would love to get to know you. There's some connection cards. Those are in the seat back in front of you. You can grab those connection cards, fill that out, drop it in the offering bag. Someone on our staff team will call you this week. We're not going to spam you. We just want to hear from you. We want to hear your story. We want to pray for you. We want to tell you about great things happening in our church. There's also a new people's table, and that's out in the lobby, and you can stop by that table on your way out. And for those of you watching this service online, thank you for being with us, and we hope that you're having a great worship experience as well. Well, men. Oh, come on. Men. I've got two important announcements for all my guys. This Wednesday night, we are going to gather in this room. We call it the men's gathering. It happens once a quarter. It's happening this Wednesday, 7 p.m., April 19th. Guys, who's coming? I hope it's just not just me and Kevin. Come on, guys. Oh, I want to invite all of you men, to join me, all of our pastoral team, and so many other guys around Christian Assembly as we fill this room with a holy roar. We're going to be worshiping the Lord, hearing a great teaching, and then we're going to go outside and have coffee and donuts and just have a time of fellowship. So, guys, make it a point to be here this Wednesday night for the men's gathering. And also, guys, we're about a month away from our men's conference entitled Contend. And that's going to be an exciting two-day event, Friday night and Saturday, May 19th and 20th, where we come together for an extended time of worship, an extended time of learning, breakout sessions, so much good stuff. Details on how to register is in the lobby. You'll see some boxing gloves out there and a card that has a QR code. Scan that QR code and you get registered for the men's conference called Contend. Guys, don't miss out on these two powerful events. A few other announcements for you. One, a team from CA is going to Tijuana, Mexico, and they're going to be going to La Roca. And so if you have any desire in joining that team, we'd love to have you join that group. You can find information on how to register for that trip on our website, and that's in the month of May. Fusion is our young adult community, 18 to 35-year-olds. They meet Sunday nights at 6, and they're also hosting a conference entitled Revive. And so if you are 18 to 35, I'd love to invite you to join that conference. That's, again, happening in the month of April. If you know somebody 18 to 35, would you whisper to them, hey, you should go to this Revive conference. There's some information in the lobby as to how to register. Love to get you connected with that. There's going to be a lot of great learning on topics such as prayer, mental health, dating, and more. So again, 18 to 35 year olds, that's for you. And finally, if you are a senior, we have a place for you as well. We have a seasoned seniors potluck, and that's happening this Thursday. Details on our website. We'd love for you to be a part of that as well. We're going to continue worshiping. We get to continue. One of the ways that we worship is through singing of songs, but another way that we worship is by giving of our tithes and offerings. And so we're going to transition into that part of our worship. But before I do that, let me read from the Bible. Psalms 9:1 says, give thanks to the Lord with all of our hearts and tell of all of God's wonderful deeds. And so as we prepare our hearts to worship in this way, would you join me in prayer? Lord, we're so grateful for so many things that are happening around the life of our church, Lord. But we're especially grateful for the ability that we have to worship you with all of our hearts, Lord. And Lord, we pray that you would bless us as we give, whether it's here in the service or online through our app, however we give, Lord. And we just even ask that you'd bless those that are in a financial need at this moment as well, Father God. Would you meet them and meet their need? Thank you, Lord, because you're a generous God. You're a good God who gives life, Lord. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, you may come.
Well, it is so good to be with you this weekend. Anybody joining us online, as Marvin said, glad to have you with us as well. If you're visiting, my name is Matt. Always such an honor to have anybody spending this time together with our church family. Well, something big happened here last weekend, and what an incredible weekend it was for Easter. I hope that whether you were here or across the street in the north, I hope you had as much fun as those of us in the tent. It was just an awesome time. I want to share with you a few numbers that just give a kind of snapshot of our weekend. Over 4,000 people were in attendance here for Easter last weekend. 650 of them were kids. And by the way, our kids' church team just does an incredible job. They present the message of Easter to our kids and make sure that our kids know that they are loved by God. 418 of you volunteered to make the Easter service happen. An army of 400 volunteers, incredible. By our best count, 175 people who were with us last weekend responded to the invitation to surrender their lives to Jesus and to trust and follow him. Yeah. 73 of those were kids, 102 in the adult services. So our pastoral team's following up with everyone who gave us one of those response cards, whether it's a new commitment to follow Jesus or wanting to be baptized or wanting to serve or to grow, whatever it is, we're following up with those people to help them take some action in their faith. God is good. And the good news about Jesus is still good news. And the Spirit of God is still changing lives. Well, we're starting a new teaching series this weekend called Running with the Giants. And I'm going to get to carry us through the teaching time this weekend. The people of ancient Greece wanted to believe that they were descended from giants who shaped the earth and passed down to the Greek people, if not height, then the fearless courage and the limitless reach of giants on the world stage. And I think it's human nature in all generations, in all places, that we exalt those who came before us. And to think that if the people if the people who we come from were great, then surely we can be great too. But what really produces greatness? The Bible is a collection of 66 books written by at least 40 different authors over at least 1,500 years, the Bible's being written, on three different continents, Southern Europe, Western Asia, and North Africa. It is a remarkable record of people's lives as they encounter and worship and serve and trust and reject and question and run to and run from and hope in and wrestle in their relationship with the living God, who, by the way, is never far from any of them and is always reaching, always revealing and rescuing with truth and love. One of the greatest qualities, I think, of the stories recorded in the Bible is what can only be described as honesty. Of course, there are miracles and otherworldly visions. There's poetry and prophecy and symbolism and all of that. And yet the writers of the Bible, they make no effort to improve or to sugarcoat the stories of the people in the Bible. It kind of reminds me of one Sunday when I was in the bathroom in the lobby over here and I was washing my hands, and there was an older guy standing next to me, and he was getting his hands wet, and he was doing this with his hair, and he was working on his hair, and finally he looked at himself and he said, "That's as pretty as I'm going to get." Well, that's kind of the honesty of the people that we find in the Bible. Unlike the ancient Greeks, the writers of the Bible have no delusions of being descended from giants. Greatness in the Bible, greatness is not in our blood, but in our faith and in our willingness to live by faith. That's what the Bible tells us. And so in this series, Running with the Giants, we're looking for men and women whose faith casts a giant shadow and who can help us build our faith. And most of the characters that we're going to encounter along the way in this series, they're very much like us. None of them are perfect, but they lived by faith. And their stories inspire and challenge us to live by faith today. And so the first giant that we're going to run with is someone that we know actually very, very little about. We don't even know her name. Her story takes up almost a whole chapter of John's gospel. So her story indeed casts a big shadow. In fact, she carries on the longest single conversation with Jesus recorded in the Bible. And she's often just called a Samaritan woman or the woman at the well. Her story is found in John chapter 4. The verses are in your bulletins. They'll be on the screens as well. And I want us to learn from this woman's story. Let me kind of set the stage before we jump into it. Jesus is beginning to make himself known throughout the region of Israel. He has a few followers, but not everyone is happy with the attention and the influence that Jesus is beginning to have. He's starting to stir up the status quo, especially in Jerusalem. And so Jesus decides to head back to Galilee. He's on his way from Jerusalem back up to Galilee, and that's where we pick up the story on his trip back. Verse 4 of John chapter 4. It says he had to travel through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the property that Jacob had given his son Joseph. And Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, worn out from his journey, sat down at the well. It was about noon. Now, all these little details matter. Jesus had to travel through Samaria. And he stops in a specific town at a very specific well that is filled with biblical significance. And notice, it was in the middle of the day when he got there. Verse 7, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. "Give me a drink," Jesus said to her, because his disciples had gone into town to buy food. "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a Samaritan woman?" she asks him. For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. So John's letting us know, he's painting a picture. There's a history of division here, and Jesus is crossing the divide. Verse 10, Jesus answered, "If you knew the gift of God and who is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would ask him and he would give you living water." Living water is running water. It's water flowing continually from a spring, not the kind of still water that's collected in a well or a cistern. Verse 11, she says, "Sir, you don't even have a bucket and the well is deep. Where are you going to get this living water? You aren't greater than our father Jacob, are you? He gave us the well. He drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." And Jesus said, "Oh, everyone who drinks from this water will get thirsty again. But whoever drinks from the water I will give him will never get thirsty again. In fact, the water I will give him will become a well of water springing up in him for eternal life." "Sir," the woman said to him, "give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to come here every day and draw water." Now, she either thinks she's calling this peddler's bluff here or she's sincere, but either way, Jesus is about to make this a very personal conversation. Verse 16, "Go call your husband," he told her, "and come back here." "I don't have a husband," she answered. "You've correctly said, 'I don't have a husband,'" Jesus said, "for you've had 5 husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." 5 husbands, this woman said. That's a lot for 21st century standards, much less. And it's hard to imagine 5 marriages ended with the husband's death. But what we also have to take into account is that a woman of her status in Roman-occupied Samaria could not divorce her husband. The husband could divorce her, but she could not take that action against him. So that most likely, she has been abandoned, not once, not twice, but as many as 5 times this woman has been abandoned by a husband. And not being the spring chicken she once was, and with her history, she's now taken what she can get with another man in a situation she never wanted. You can imagine what the other women have to say about her in town. "What's wrong with her? Why can't she hold on to a husband? She must be troubled. There's something wrong there." Can you imagine what they said? So she comes to the well all alone in the middle of the day. All the other women in town, they gather early in the morning, in the cool of the morning, to begin the day with water for their families. In fact, it was a social time for these women to come together. It's where friendship happened, but not for this woman. She waits until she can go to the well alone, so she doesn't have to talk with anyone, doesn't have to explain her situation or retell her story. That's who this is. And she is why Jesus had to travel through Samaria. There was a road that Jewish travelers took, we know, that avoided Samaria altogether. But John says Jesus had to go through Samaria. He had to arrive at this well at this time of day because he came for her. Now he's got her attention, and she turns to questions about religion. "Sir," the woman replied, "I see that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews say that the place of worship is in Jerusalem." And Jesus told her, "Believe me, woman, an hour is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you don't know. We worship what we do know, because salvation is from the Jews. But an hour is coming and is now here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Yes, the Father wants such people to worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth." And the woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When He comes, He'll explain all of this to us." Now, not every Samaritan was expecting the Messiah. But this woman longs for salvation only God can give her. And Jesus told her, verse 26, "I, the one speaking to you, am He." Jesus breaks boundaries to find people who are genuinely seeking Him. And that's why Jesus had to come to Samaria, to let her know the Messiah, the Savior of the world, had come for her. Verse 27, "Just then His disciples arrived. They're amazed that He was talking with a woman, but nobody said anything. What's going on here? None of that. Verse 28, "The woman left her water jar, went into town and told the people, 'Come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?' And they left the town and made their way to Him." This lonely woman who keeps to herself, suddenly she can't keep to herself what has just happened with Jesus. And so we're going to go to school in this woman's story with the rest of our time. And I want us to learn from three lessons that she teaches us about the uncontainable life that Jesus offers you and me. So here we go. First, her story tells us that life with Jesus cannot be contained in the limits and boundaries of human design. Not in boundaries on a map, not in cultural or ethnic bias, not in social norms or religious customs. Life with Jesus cannot be contained. You cannot box in the Spirit of God, and you cannot compartmentalize the truth of God. There are a lot of containers in this story in chapter 4. I don't know if you noticed that. The well is a container. The woman's jar is a container. Jesus, when He speaks about living water, I love the woman's response is, "You don't even have a bucket. No container." There are a lot of containers here. Jesus is not limited, though, by any of them. He's not limited by the boundaries that contain Samaria. He's not limited by the worship contained in this place or that place. He's not limited by the shame that contains this woman in lonely isolation. There's a tendency in all of us to contain things in our lives, to set limits and compartmentalize our lives in all kinds of containers, private and public, work and home. Parts of our past we don't want to deal with, we'll put it in a container and label it, ignore this. We draw boundaries around prejudice and bias. We draw deeply divided political boundaries. People who don't agree with us, we just put them in containers labeled dangerous. Containers give us a sense of control, whether false or otherwise. People try limiting Jesus or limiting faith to a religious container, a container for sacred rites and ceremonies. If I keep my worship contained to this room, if I keep my faith contained in silence, if I keep my relationship with God contained to private prayer, then it won't interfere with my relationships or at work. The woman at the well sees all the containers, but Jesus is not limited by any of them. He will not be contained. Not in a religious container, not in a private container, not in a weekend container or a life group container. Any attempt to contain life with Jesus will result in a thirsty search for other containers to offer you more than they can. Your career is not a spring of living water that will never run out. Your relationships, friendships, marriage, parenting, none of those containers are springs of living water pouring out life and more life. Nothing in this world will ever offer you what Jesus can and does. Are you drinking from any limited supplies of approval and achievement? Limited supplies of love and significance, when Jesus offers you an endless supply of life with Him. Have you tried containing life with Jesus in a private and religious compartment? Because He wants us to believe in Him, and He wants us to receive what He offers in an uncontainable life. That's the first lesson that we learned from this woman at the well. Here's the second. The uncontainable life that Jesus offers is dependent upon the power of the Holy Spirit. Religion is often thought of as a container, as I mentioned, for sacred do's and don'ts. Depending on the kind of place you worship or the kind of prayers you pray. And the idea that we often run into in our world is this idea to not mix your religion into other containers. Ironically, though, the word religion originally meant something else. The word religion comes from a Latin word meaning to rely on. What you rely on is your religion. Jesus wasn't interested in a new religious container. Jesus calls into question, what are you relying on? Whatever you're convinced your life depends upon, that's your religion. I recently talked to a friend who is facing some difficulty at work. I've known this woman and her husband for a long time, and she was talking about her job. She was talking about how stressful it can be because of a dynamic of competition and conflict among her coworkers. And she asked me, how do I deal with all of this as a believing follower of Jesus? So I shared with her a brilliant and, in hindsight, long-winded answer. And when I finished talking, she said to me, if I understand you, then you're saying that my relationship with God is not just a part of my life. God has to be the center of every area of my life. And I said, yes, you just said it better than me. Jesus offers us life, not just a part of our lives, not just a church part or a spiritual part, but life with God at the center of every part. What would happen if your faith and your reliance upon Jesus filled every compartment of your life? How does that happen? Jesus explained it when he spoke about living water again later in John's gospel. It's in chapter 7, verse 39. He says, or John tells us, when Jesus said living water, he was speaking of the Spirit who would be given to everyone believing in him. It happens when we rely on the Spirit of God to produce in us what we cannot produce for ourselves in this life that Jesus wants to give us. The living water Jesus spoke about is a source of life from the Spirit of God that never runs out, never runs dry, and can never be contained. It is always moving, flowing, springing, gushing, running, pouring, living water, encouraging, inspiring, strengthening, empowering, helping, producing in us life that Jesus wants to give us. Yeah, it is true. It is true. In our last series, Real ID, we talked about the fruit of the Spirit. And we talked about the gifts of the Spirit. God wants to fill our lives with the Holy Spirit, to give us love and joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, the fruit of the Spirit. And that fruit is not limited to when I am doing spiritual things. The uncontainable life that Jesus offers is the presence and power of the Holy Spirit available to you and me in all things, in every circumstance and relationship, every decision and action. May Jesus be our religion. May Jesus be the source of life we rely on in all that we do. Now here's the third and final lesson I want to tell you. This woman teaches us about the uncontainable life with Jesus. The uncontainable life with Jesus in you will compel others to seek and trust Him too. That life with Jesus in you will compel others to seek and trust Him too. The woman at the well, she arrives with a bucket, with a container. But when she realizes who Jesus is and what He's offering, she leaves that jar behind. She's no longer concerned with the containers that have defined her. This woman who used to keep to herself, contained by the shame of her past, she can't keep to herself anymore what Jesus has shared with her. John never tells us her name. But early in the history of Christianity, people began to attribute a name to this woman. They called her Photin. It's a Greek word, which means one who shines. She shines with her message about Jesus. She glows from her encounter with him. Her story is a spotlight on the Savior. She used to keep her story from ever being the topic of any conversation, but now she has a new story, and she'll tell it anywhere to anyone to stir curiosity about the one who came to find her. Look at what John tells us at the end of this story in chapter 4, verse 39. Now many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of what the woman said when she testified. He told me everything I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. Many more believed because of what he said. And I love this. They told the woman, "We no longer believe because of what you said, since we've heard for ourselves and know that this really is the Savior of the world." Amen. I love that the people who met Jesus say to her, it's not just you didn't convince us of this. It was our encounter with him. It was the words he spoke to us. The woman made them curious. She showed them the way. She invited them to discover Jesus and what he was offering them. And they were convinced by the words that he spoke to them. She was so filled with life from her encounter with Jesus, that life was just spilling out of her. Does life from the Spirit of God spill out of you unto others? Does your life with Jesus, your faith, make anyone curious? Are you pointing the way for anyone to come and see for themselves what Jesus offers them? I wonder who you know that needs to hear an invitation to know and trust Jesus. I want us to do something together before we leave that I think will help us take action. And like this woman, seek ways to make others curious and perhaps even invite some to hear for themselves and consider what Jesus offers. In the seat back in front of you, you'll notice there's a blank index card, just like this one. Might have lines on it, or it might just be solid white. I want you to find one of those index cards. And I want you to think of someone who you know in your life, who you want to invite them to investigate. You want to invite them to consider what Jesus offers. Not to convince them. Let him do that by his word. But you would invite them. And I want you to just write their name on this card. Don't write anything about them. Don't say it's my uncle, my brother, my sister, nothing like, don't give me an address or a phone number or nothing. Just the name. You can just put the first name. And what we're going to do with these is we're going to collect these cards with those names. And we're going to collect these cards, and we're going to display them in various places around the building, around the campus, as a reminder in the weeks and months to come to be praying for that person on your card and looking for an opportunity that Jesus gives you to invite them to come and hear the Word of God at Christian Assembly. So I want you to write a name on here, and we'll put them up as a reminder. We've done this a couple of times before in the past, and I'll never forget, it's been a few years since we did this, I'll never forget the last time that we did it. We had the cards up in different places, and there was a large sign out in the courtyard that probably had 100 of these cards on them. And I was standing out there one Sunday, and this family came walking up. In fact, every time I tell this story, it chokes me up. Family came walking up that ramp. Mom, dad, two little girls. And one of the daughters holding her dad's hand, dragging him behind her up that ramp. Biggest smile on her face. Running with her dad, pointing it at that sign, at one of those cards, saying, "Look, look, Dad, there's your name. There's your name right there." Who do you know whose name needs to be lifted up and mentioned in prayer? Who do you know who needs to investigate and hear the Word of God for them? Jesus had to go to Samaria to find that woman. Who's somebody we got to go find to invite them to know Him? I want to run with the woman at the well. I want to leave the bucket behind, and I want to receive this gift of uncontainable life in all that I do. I want to run in a way that makes others curious to know the one who knows everything I ever did and still offers me life that never ends. I want to run in a way that shines the spotlight on Jesus and invites others to look and see and listen and hear the Word of God that'll never pass away. I want to run in a way that compels others to run with me and find for themselves the Savior of the world. Once you put a name on that card, carry it out with you. The ushers will be in the back. You can drop it in a bucket. Alex, would you lead it?